All of you here. He has been serving as our state school superintendent since for the last 4 years. Elected in 2014 for his first term. He's now running for re-election. Richard Woods has, he grew up, he's like me. He's a native Floridian who saw the light and moved north. So, but as a military brat, lived really all over until his family kind of settled in South Georgia, where he went to school in Fitzgerald, and has more than 22 years in public education on just about every level, from teacher to principal, and before being elected our state school superintendent. So without further ado, Richard Woods.
Again, it's a pleasure to be with you. Again, I want to thank you again for your support, the support you gave me in 2014 and the continuing support. It is indeed an extreme honor to represent you at the state level as state school superintendent to really put our focus on, you know, 1.8 million children. Again, as Mr. Tippins, I think, you know, mentioned, you know, this is like that for anyone running for office. It is what it is. I don't care whether it's local or state. It is a big endeavor. And so for those that are running, again, my best to you, you know, because it takes a big step. And I thank you again for those that work on the campaigns and support, because that is a lot of sacrifice in your time as well. But as I look, and again, as I mentioned, I am running for re-election. It is something that that when I look back, that I've always told people, re-election is not necessarily that has been the heart of what I do. But I think at this time, to make sure we continue the good things that are going on, this is why I'm here. When I look at education, and again, when I ran, you know, 4 years ago, one of the things I look at, and again, trying to say, why should you vote for me again, is that, you know, the things I ran on 4 years ago is what I stood by. You know, that has been a pledge to me. You know, again, growing up, I think for myself in a Southern family, my word is my bond. I did not come in this to be a politician, but I did come in this to do a job. And that is a job that I think we have been very successful with over the past several years. It is not one that, I'll be honest, is probably the hardest job that I've ever done in my life. But it is something that, you know, because of our children, because of our state, because of our future, we need to make sure we're on the right path. 4 years ago, as I came to you, you know, I talked about, you know, making sure that our focus was on children and not a test. We have done that, and I appreciate, again, the work of Senator Tippins as well with Senate Bills 364. You know, we have seen the largest decrease in mandated testing in our state's history. And I guarantee you, for teachers, that means I can spend more time with our kids knowing and doing what they need to do. Because as a teacher, I can honestly share this. Now, you think about, who is your best teacher? Who is your favorite teacher? I don't know that person. But what I can guarantee you this is that person had a relationship with you. That is the key to education. That is the key to being a family member. That's the key to being a mom and dad. Is to knowing those people and building relationships. And so we have done that. Also, we have been able to reduce the number of mandated, you know, observations that a teacher has to have. You know, for years we said that each and every teacher had to have 6 observations. That was a complete waste of time. It is not rocket science to know who is doing their job and who is not doing the job. And so we have, you know, been able to look at and reduce that. And also, again, as an individual, again, growing up in a military family, you know, I understand the need we have in building our basics. We talk about building a foundation. And I work in Atlanta, and I look at the tall skyscrapers that are out there. And I tell people, I said, the most important thing out there with those buildings is not what you see, but is what you don't see. That is the foundation. That foundation, the depth of that foundation, allows those buildings to go up. And that is where, for myself, being a high school teacher, and again, a wife who was with me today that worked at elementary school, knowing that K-5 education is the most important formative years that we have in K-12 education. You know, and again, growing up in a military family, I will tell you unequivocally, the most important skill that we can have and transfer to our kids is reading. That is bar none. I don't care what test you take, what course you go into, where you go in life. You have to have the ability to read to take off. And one of the things we have looked at since taking office is that prior to coming into office, we did not have a statewide literacy reading plan. We have a plan now, and we are enacting that across the state. You know, one of the individuals, in fact, one of the first hires I had was a young lady that I wanted to make sure that it was the best person we could find that knew what reading was and how we can move that. And so I appreciate the work of Dr. Caitlin Dooley and what she is doing. She is not only recognized within our state, but within our nation as far as her ability to address reading concerns. Also, as we look at, you know, trying to put, you know, the emphasis on reading as well, and looking at, you know, giving our kids books. And this will be the third year that we will be able to give out over 100,000 books to students and kids throughout Georgia. And again, for many of these children, we will be doing that. We will be doing so, which the only book they probably have is a phone book. And so we have to get books and have that printed, material in front of their hands. And we continue to make improvements on math as well. That was one thing that for years we really kind of did a bad job. You know, math is not that hard. We've been doing it for thousands of years. But I think within the state, within the nation, we made it extremely hard. There is nothing wrong with teaching math the way that we learn math that as individuals growing up. Yes. And to be honest, as an individual, I always, you know, kind of go back to my college professor, and I think it was probably one of the wisest, you know, sayings. He said, Richard said, what you need to do is keep it simple. You know, and that's what we need to do. We have overcomplicated education and made it far more complicated. And again, unfortunately, I think that comes from the federal government. Again, if it was myself, I think from a constitutional standpoint, we should not have a federal Department of Education. Right. It is the right of a state to govern. And I would say that it's not necessarily the right of the state, but it is the right of the local level. And this is where that we have tried, and I'm working to make sure that we push and give the locals the control that they should have. And again, for us at the Department of Education, we are not here to tell you how to do education, but we are here to support and make sure that we allow you to, and again, as you know your kids and know the direction that you want to go in, that we are in that. But I am also here to tell you today that education has definitely changed. You know, I look as an individual who grew up in public education, who worked in public education, is now superintendent over public education. I probably visited more schools than anyone, you know, within our state, except maybe the first lady. I think she probably may have an edge on me, but she does have 4 years, so maybe in 4 years we can, you know, catch that. But I would say that as I go to schools and I've looked at what our kids have, they have great opportunities. And I would here say that the good thing about, or the good news about public education today is that we have a lot of great things going on. And we have great things going on because of what we've accomplished within the past 3 years. For the first time that I'm aware of, we actually now have a personal finance course that can be offered to each and every child in the state of Georgia. Our kids need to know how to manage money. That is probably one, if not the most important question. Not where exactly I want it to do, but again, you know what I found out is that sometimes you get a lot of opposition to common sense when it comes to politics. Yeah. And so we are going to push that. And again, I hope one day it is a one-to-one, you know, where the Board of Regents accepts that course and says, you know, either you take an econ class or you take this personal finance course. I can guarantee you, we don't need, you know, hundreds of thousands of economists in the state of Georgia, but every child can benefit from personal finance. Also, what we've been able to accomplish over the past couple of years is that now we have American history being taught not 1 year, but 2 years in our elementary age. And that is something that we desperately need. We need to know what the truth about our history is. We should not be ashamed of U.S. history. Yeah. Again, that's something that we need to be proud of. If given a second term, it is my desire to make sure that not only we see 2 years of U.S. history in elementary, but I hope we can see that we have 2 years of U.S. history in high school as well. That is something we desperately need because the thinking and the process and, again, understanding is things that we need to look at. We're looking at even adding, you know, SEALs. One of the things we looked at trying to expand that opportunity is to put something out there for individuals that, you know, our kids can have the option, you know, to take a citizenship test. Again, to let us know that, yes, our kids actually know what it means to be a citizen of the United States. And so we continue to push that. That will be something we will be rolling out. It's not mandatory, but I do believe that our social studies teachers will buy into that because there are other great things that go on. Again, talking about a civic engagement piece. you know, doing things for your community, whether it's, you know, such as you had, you know, helping out maybe a homeless shelter, or, you know, looking at becoming involved in the political system. Those are things that our kids need to know. And as we look at building and moving forward with that, one of the things that we did not have in place, you know, prior to coming into office, and we did not have an individual that dealt with fine arts. And I'm talking about band, music, dance, drama, the visual arts. Those are important classes that our kids need to have. Again, until I came in office, we did not have an individual that even dealt with fine arts at the department. In fact, we had a 23-year absence of that individual. But now we have a young lady by the name of Jessica Booth who is doing a fantastic job. We have reworked our standards. We are seeing a revitalization, I would say even a renaissance in that area. That, when we talk about investment, that is what we need to invest in. You know, we need to make sure we prioritize what benefits our children. And again, those are things that open up those doors. Today as well, we're seeing a great revival, what we call science, technology, engineering, and math. That's STEM education. We have about 70 schools that are STEM certified. Right now, we have about 1,100 schools that are waiting to become STEM certified. These are the jobs of the future. This is the education that needs to take place, because it is not a science teacher working in isolation, but this is a whole school working together. This is a school being involved, and again, bringing in business, bringing in the outside community, working together as a state to improve in education. But also, we did not stop there, because now we have STEAM certification. We have put the fine arts into education, and there's actually another, certification we can, build on. But I've told my staff, I'm going to let you get a little bit of time to build on this. We are seeing great opportunities. You know, again, I am not an individual that likes the one-size-fits-all mentality. For years, as a state, as a nation, we said that every child was going to a four-year university. That was the biggest mistake we ever did to public education. Oh, yeah. Not every child was going to a four-year university. I started my career at a technical school. I know the value of a technical college. And that's one of the things we have looked at, expanding and making sure that we are offering courses across the state. In fact, right now, our career tech program, or what you would probably hear me refer to as CTAE, it is recognized as probably the number one, number two program in the nation. Not just, just regionally, but we are talking, that is the strength of what we're doing. And I appreciate the work of Dr. Wall as she has, come and really taken that to the next level. People are now coming to Georgia to see how that works. We are seeing an expansion in our skills program. So if you're a carpenter, a mason, electrician, plumbing, those are jobs that we are now preparing our young people for. Because right now, the average age in the state of Georgia, as we look at that, is about 60. So you can see these individuals are, again, aging out. And we have to have individuals that can replace them. There are, one of the things I like to share is over the winter break or Christmas break we had, our heat pump went out. Well, I did not call my college professor to fix my heat pump, okay? But I do know how much I paid that individual that came out there. There is great money to be made. If you're a welder, if you're an HVAC or anything like that, to be honest, you make more money than a starting teacher. And those are things you can look at. But that being said, we need to make sure that we have the very best teachers that are educating our young people. And that means meeting those needs and, again, allowing them to do the job that they wanted to do. And that's something we're trying to look at. We have students, we have teachers, and we have bureaucracy in the middle. You know, it has been my job to make sure we remove the bureaucracy and allow our teachers to do what they need to do. And that will just, again, continue to build on the surplus and, again, the success we are seeing. But also, as we look at giving our kids opportunities, one of the things we appreciate is the General Assembly making, some changes in our labor laws. We can actually now have students having true internships with business. We need to have children out there in business and working. And again, one of the things we look at, and one of the probably the companies that I like to highlight, is a company called Pratt down in Columbus, Georgia. They make jet engines. But we have high school students making jet engines. They are not only making jet engines, but they are probably, I think, getting paid anywhere from $11 to $15 an hour. Well, I remember making $3.25 an hour. That's pretty good money. But not only is Pratt saying that we will do this for you, but we will allow you to come out and we will pay for your future education because we want you to come back. And this is just an example of what we are talking about, working with individuals. Right now, this past year, we had over 20,000 students taking internships, and that number continues to grow. We've also have, 35 students receive industry credential certification.
So not only can you look at, maybe I want to go to college, I want to go to a technical school, but now I can go straight into the workforce. Those are things about providing our students options. We have to expand things. I think the diversity, whether you go to a four-year university, military, technical school, internship, you know, taking, you know, mom and dad's business or creating your own business, those are opportunities we have to have. For Georgia to continue to grow, we must have that diversification. But that also means that we are now talking with business. And that was one of the things that I'm a, you know, former small business owner. I worked in a cotton mill. I've worked in a peanut mill. I've been a janitor of a church. I've been, you know, a national, international laser purchasing agent. But we have to engage business. You know, we have to make sure that as business comes to Georgia, that we are missionary minded. We are going to them and saying, what are the needs that you have? Right now, we have just had a little company out southwest of Georgia called Pinewood Studios. Now, this industry, the entertainment film industry, you know, just a few years ago was about, about a $200 million industry. Within Georgia today, it is $9 billion and growing. But we are looking at increasing, you know, having those conversations, saying, what do we need to continue that growth? It said, we need writers. We need people who are script writers and doing some things that can add to the value and bring all of that industry to Georgia. We do not have that now. Most people have to go out to California to do that. So we are talking with them. Right now we have, you know, the cyber command coming in from Augusta. Well, we now have cyber security courses that we are offering to give our kids, you know, experience with that. But again, we know that that involves computer science. Georgia is the leading state when it comes to computer science. In fact, we were the only state recently to go up to Washington, D.C. and have a conversation with the Department of Defense because of our work in personalization and computer science. That is something where we are taking a lead. Again, as an individual who represents you as the state, are we where we need to be? You know, yet no. But we are moving and we are making leaps and bounds. I can tell you that Georgia is growing in a way in which I have never seen as an educator. You know, the work that I've seen in Marietta City, Cobb, and the surrounding areas is just phenomenal. You know, our kids, they have the opportunity. And we need to make sure we make the investment to continue that growth across the state. And again, I think with another 4 years, we will see that. Now, as I close, I do wish to share, again, this is a contested race. It's something where I had two individuals get into the, you know, the primary at the week of qualification. But I would say this, I will encourage anyone. Again, I'm an old coach as well, and I don't run from competition. But if you want to put them out there and see what my record is against any of their records, go to our websites and visit our websites. I guarantee you will leave with only one, you know, conclusion, that Richard Woods, that I'm the best person for the job to keep this growth going. And again, one of the individuals that is running, he was a former superintendent that I replaced. There was a reason I ran, to make sure that we got rid of the stuff he put in place. He brought us Common Core. I have stopped the spread of Common Core in the state of Georgia. He gave us those six observations. We have reeled those back to where it's practical. He did nothing in fine arts. Well, I've expanded, you know, the ability to, you know, to look at STEM and STEAM, opportunities within the state. You know, as a military child, I have put that first and foremost. This April is actually Military Child Month. We are doing things to give and support our military families, because we have to make sure that we keep these bases in here and protect Georgia from any type of reduction from BRAC or anything that comes up in Washington, D.C. And I can assure you, as a military individual, if you treat their children right, they will stay in the state of Georgia. And we have to make sure that we continue to do that. I hope that we will continue to expand ROTC in the state of Georgia. That's something I think is a great program. Our FFA programs are great. This is where leadership is taking place. And the one other thing that I would kind of mention about my opponent is that in 2014, as a sitting Republican in office, he endorsed my Democratic opponent, you know, in the general. So that kind of lets you know where we stand. There is a big difference when it comes to what one says they want to do and what they have done. And I think for myself, you know, I have shown that what I say I'm going to do, I'm going to work on, because our children mean that much. We are seeing too much great growth in Georgia. And be honest, in four more years, it's not only that we're going to be looking at the region of the Southeast looking at Georgia, but we're going to have the nation looking at us, because they already are, and we're going to have the world looking at us. Because I can guarantee you this, we are not the number one business or state in which to do business, because we have a poor education system. We are the number one business because we have an education system that is meeting the needs of people, and we will continue to do that. And because, again, we will not sit. I will not sit on my laurels. I will not sit that. We will continue to invest. We will continue to reach out and make sure. Because for me, education means that we have opened up doors of opportunity for all kids. We have an endless ceiling of success, and we are not drawing people to the middle. So again, I thank you again. I have, some signs out front. We have maybe some literature around, but I would appreciate your support. This is not a high profile race. So if you have some spare change in the couch or in the sofa, I would appreciate some donations. The General Assembly is over. But again, please share with others. And again, thank you. It's been an honor to be with you today. Thank you.
Yes. And it's like at a very, very young level. I mean,
who's
in control of that?
I would say this. We have a set of standards at the state of Georgia. Now, abstinence is what we promote, okay? That is what I will continue to promote when it comes to sex education. Now, once you get into the local level, then what is being taught, then I would probably have to look at the local level to see the specifics. But I mean, some of the things I think you're discussing, I mean, I've heard, on talk radio and some of the other things that are out there, we do not promote that. So that is not something at the state level. In fact, next year we will actually be redoing the health standards, which are a part of that. I would contact your board members, local board members, if something is going on, that would probably be the area.
I have another question. If President Trump were to get rid of mostly or abolish the federal education and the funds would come directly to the state,
yes,
are you prepared or how can you be prepared to manage those funds?
Again, we have a budget of about $9 billion right now. So I think, in the federal investment with that is about $3 billion. So, we will continue on the services. We have the department, we have the personnel. So all you're looking at is a transfer of how those funds are divvied out. So we would continue to do our business. So we're, like I said, I would love to see that. If he would do it, give us the money, we're ready to go. So we're not waiting, we're ready on day one.
Let's do one more.
I think Mr. Tippins had mentioned that 45% of new teachers leave the profession after 3 years. I have a vested interest. I have a daughter who's been a teacher for almost 10 years in Title I schools down in South Georgia. How will you address teacher retention? And this dovetails into funding for public schools.
Okay. Well, I think, we've already done some things to help as far as looking at reduction and the de-emphasizing the test. I think that was something we had to have, looking at the reduction of the number of observations that are there. What are things that are important to our teachers? Making sure that they have, the ability to discipline, I think, is, or at least getting the support was something that we, I think need to address in the state. When you look at, pay, I think pay is something we have to have compensation for. Our teachers, they have had a lot of reductions. We've not seen a meaningful raise in years. So again, we will continue to try to, press for that. For a lot of our teachers, it means looking at insurance. I think we've already talked about a lot of the reasons our educators get into that is because of the insurance and support. And if we could have reductions in that area, but also having the support of the benefits, and I think you've had a few individuals that have mentioned that today, that would definitely help. And I think in making sure that we keep our retirement system. I mean, we have a very strong retirement system in the state of Georgia. And so those are things that we continue to look at. But also it is something that we try to do, and because I have a teacher advisory group that I meet with quarterly. And it is listening to them, saying what are some things that we need to do. And again, I would appreciate the input of anyone across the state to do that. But we are seeing some trends that I think we some things in place that will support our teachers.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
My pleasure.